Seth Ferranti was once on the U.S. Marshals' top 15 most wanted list for federal drug trafficking. He evaded authorities for 2 years before he was discovered, even faking his own death.
I never considered myself a criminal. You know, I considered myself an outlaw because I broke laws that I thought were wrong. So, I mean, I sold weed because, I mean, to me, weed and psychedelics are the righteous drugs. I almost felt like when my case happened, it was like, you know, they were like, look, we bust white drug dealers too. I was in that first wave of like weed and psychedelic dudes, you know, when they came out to the suburbs. Like, how the fuck could I be facing 20 years for like weed and LSD? And really not even a lot. How the fuck can Seth Ferranti just go away and these charges just go away and I can just be okay? I remember people always committing suicide there in Great Falls because they would jump in the water and get smashed against the rocks and drown. So it was like a popular spot for suicides. You know, I wanted to fake my suicide because that was like my plan. Then boom, I fake my suicide. My body washes out to the Atlantic Ocean. Never find my body. 7 years, I'm declared legally dead. No Seth Ferranti, no federal case. You know, so I'm good. I can just live my life as whoever. You know, but they said it's a hoax because what I did, I planned everything brilliantly, right? But I staged my suicide on the wrong side of the fucking dam, right? So my body didn't wash out to sea.
Seth served more than 2 decades in prison, and now he is a free man, and he's also become a writer and a producer. What were some of the challenges you faced as a fugitive?
You know, when you have to, like, leave your whole life, you have to, like, leave your identity. You have to become someone else and go into isolation and go into hiding. It's a really big mental burden, so that was the first thing I had to overcome.
You know, I started writing books in prison, gangster books, all gangsters, nonfiction, true crime, mostly African-American gangsters. You know, I wrote some prison stuff too, but I started a journalism career. You know, I mean, that's basically, I do true crime, I do like prison gangs. You know, I've done a lot of features for like Vice, Penthouse, a lot of foreign magazines, real crime in UK, you know, in Australia, but all like prison gangs, mafia stuff, you know, like African-American drug lords, you know, mostly like from the 80s, from the crack era, you know, kind of the ones that were lionized in the, you know, the annals of hip hop lore, you know,
like the White Boy Rick documentary, which is trending right now on Netflix, like top 10. It's got like 14, 15 million views in like the first week of April. So it's just banging. Like these guys, they just hit this the domestic market and went boom.
When I had about 10 years left, I was like, when I get out, I want to make films. You know, like this writing stuff is cool because this is the only thing I can do from here. But I'm like, you know, when I get out, I mean, that's what I want to do. I want to make films. And, you know, I got so lucky that, you know, I formed this relationship with Rick Rushi Jr. like in 2005. You know, I formed this relationship with him. You know, I started writing him. And, you know, I was like sending him his books and like copies of my articles. And he was like digging up.
The way people look at me has changed because of that film getting 20 million views in 2 months on Netflix. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
My biggest thing now is let all the nonviolent weed people out, man. I mean, there's still like, from the numbers I've read, there's still like 40,000 people locked up, nonviolent, for cannabis. Mm. Let them out, man. You know what I'm saying?